Check Raise is in the house. I wish I had something super clever to say. Had I known that was going to be the intro music, as Zach knows, I would have prepared a joke for you. It's 8 o'clock Pacific Standard Time. You are listening to the Poker Gossip Show. I'm your host, Jeff. It's Thursday. That, you know what that means? It means we like to keep it light. We like to keep it loose and try to have a great show so we can send you on your way to having a really run good weekend. You know, so much happened this week in poker media that I came up with. There were so many questions I had in my head, I thought that I would write a few down and pose them to you, to the listening audience, because I want to keep things interactive, like ask you questions and have you actually tweet at me and let me know what you think. Before I get to these three questions that I've pulled out of this week, I want to let you know that we have a great show for you tonight. It's going to be a lot of fun. Later in the second half of the show, we're going to talk with Jeffrey Romano. He goes by Hurricane Jeff, online grinder, lock poker pro. We're going to break down everything poker. We're going to talk a little bit about lock, acquiring the Cake Network, what that means for lock. We're going to see what he knows and just try to ask him those questions. Plus, of course, get into everything on the felt, WSOP. And then in just a few minutes from one of the most popular poker communities on the planet, Pocket Five's co-founder, Adam Small. He's going to be on the show. I've got a million questions for him. I've been such a fan for a long time, fan of his work from the Pocket Five's Pocket Five's podcast that I can't wait to get Adam on the show. But before we get to that, these questions were just kind of burning in my head. And I want to know what you think, because I know, like, I thought about these and, you know, I had some interesting answers when I thought about it myself. Question number one is, with 2+2 being down for almost 2 weeks or 3 weeks, and it's planning on coming back this Saturday, are you jumping right back in? Are you just jonesing for your 2+2? Or have you found that life without 2+2, is it a nice break for you? Are you going to go straight back to grinding and trolling those boards, finding the Victor Blom goes back-to-back thread and just trying to get first as soon as you can? Or have you seen the light? A life without 2+2 for a few weeks. And I wonder, what do you think that's going to do to the power of 2+2? Anything at all? For me personally, it's been a welcome relief. You know, it's opened me up. I've visited a bunch of other forums. Of course, I've visited Pocket Fives. I've been a member of Pocket Fives for years. Full Contact, you know, Daniel's been posting all of his stuff there. And you just kind of get out there and realize that 2+2, while they do believe that they are the hub of the poker community, that it's not the absolute end all and that life did go on without 2+2. That's not to say I won't be happy to have it back. I definitely will. But I'll tell you what, it does loosen its grip on my forum brain and is allowing me to say, yeah, you know, I'll go check out a few other places to get my information, to find funny threads or whatever memes, or try to be first in a thread on somewhere else. So I wonder about you. Are you just jonesing for your 2+2, or has it been, you know, kind of a surprise? Are you surprised with how it's been without them? They are planning on being back this Saturday, so good for them. Hopefully it'll come back. I think a lot of people are speculating that's going to be 2+2 version 2 or version 3, I think I should say, but a new software. We can't wait to see what they do. We talked about this a little bit in the pre-show. If you weren't with us, Poker A is on right before the Poker Gossip Show on Thursdays, and Dennis and I sometimes go back and forth. We were talking about Victor Blom. Victor Blom takes down back-to-back scoop events. Now, if you're in the U.S. and you're watching this, because we've had some amazing coverage right here on Quad Jacks, if you happen to listen to this while scoop's going on, Zach and the gang, he's bringing on a lot of top-name pros, and they're streaming live final tables of scoop events with commentary without hole cards. And it's been very interesting, the strategy, the breakdown, the conversation. Been getting David the Maven on, Tragedy, John Kim, Joe Tehan, and even Sean Deeb came on right after his victory. I believe that was in the stud event. But it's been great, and they're going to continue to do it, so make sure you check it out. But for me, I've been watching these, and really, I know that I've always missed online poker, that the pastime part of it, maybe a little bit of the grind. But I haven't had the urge to play since Black Friday U.S.-facing sites. But when I see this, all of a sudden my brain starts going, God, maybe I should try out X Poker Room or Y Poker Room U.S.-facing sites. And I'm wondering to my friends who are here in the U.S., do you feel the same way when you hear about Scoop and Victor Blom and back-to-back? Does it bring back that rush of online poker for you? Because it's doing that for me, and I want to know if I'm alone out there. And if I'm not, like, what should I do about it? Do you think I should try these things, or is it definitely stay away? I want you to hit me up and let me know what you think about that. And finally, on Tuesday, we brought you a pretty in-depth, you know, Kevin Mathers, Rich T. Ryan, Pokerati Dan and myself. We really dissected that WSOP conference call. I don't know that we left out anything. We brought you even the questions. So if you have any interest in what goes on in the WSOP media conference call, you should check out last Tuesday's show. We had a really good time. It's a little long, but that was my fault. I didn't streamline it. Check that out. But think about this. The 2012 WSOP is 16 days away. It's like 2 weeks away until summer camp for poker is here. Can you feel the excitement? Are you excited? Or is it wake you when the main event comes on? Because when I was listening to the WSOP conference call, I was really excited. And then today, Poker News announced that the WSOP on WSOP.com, they are going to stream just about, if not every live table. And of course, friend of this program, a great guy, Dave Tuckman, is going to be helming the commentary on it. And he's going to be joined by big-name pros. And if you happen to be a pro, I know we have a few who listen to the show. You can contact Who Jedi if you want to get on there to be with Tuckman. But can you feel it? Is it palpable yet? Or are you still waiting for the coverage to start? Or does it start only after the casino event employees event is over? When are you going to get excited? When you're finally on a plane and you're hopped going over there? Or when you get to finally watch stuff online? When do you start to really get excited about the WSOP? I want to know these things. Feel free to hit me up, PokerGossip, PKRGSSP, @gmail.com. Or, of course, Twitter. I'm way more active on Twitter, or at least I try to be, especially with people who tweet at me, @PKRGSSP. Definitely interested in what you think. Feel free to hit me up anytime. That being said, I would like to now, sir, I'd like to bring on my very first guest. I'd like to welcome to the show. He's one of the co-founders. It's one of the most popular poker forums, as well as it's the definitive online poker player rankings. It's Pocket Fives. In addition to that, he does writing. He also develops features for Pocket Fives. You may have also heard him as the voice of the Pocket Fives podcast. Let me see if he's out there yet. We are reaching out right now to Adam Small. Not sure if he's online, or maybe he's muted.
Hey,
there he is. Adam, how are you?
Hey, I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks so much for joining us on the show. I know normally you're on the other side when you had done the podcast in the past for Pocket Fives, but now we've got you in the interviewee chair.
Yeah, this is more fun for me, actually, these days. I haven't been doing the podcast for a while, but I like it. It's less responsibility when I don't have to write the questions.
Yeah, I'm sure you understand that it doesn't even necessarily have to be done right, but it still takes a ton of time. You want to prep. You want to make sure you get everything right. It can get a little nerve-wracking sometimes. But, Adam, right off the bat, what I'd like to ask you is, I mentioned at the top of the show, you know, 2+2, it's been down for about 2.5 or 3 weeks. Have you seen a nice spike over at Pocket Fives? I know it's always popular, but what kind of surge in traffic and participation are you seeing over at P5s right now?
We've had a little bit of a surge. It hasn't been anything crazy. We have this one thread on the site that people have been talking about, 2+2, just kind of asking when it's going to be back up. And a few names have popped in that I recognized from 2+2 that I hadn't seen posting before on Pocket Fives, and that was nice to see. But I think that in a lot of ways, maybe some people that aren't real familiar with P5s think of us as maybe kind of a smaller 2+2, but I think we cater to a different audience in a lot of ways, and in some ways to an overlapping audience, but not so much. We're not so much the kind of site that I guess 2+2ers would all come to as their second option, really, because we do a lot of different things with the rankings and with the off-topic forum and some of the new local stuff we're doing, and so I guess it's just a little bit different. But we have had a little bit of an uptick for sure.
I know that's where I started out. I actually I might be a bit reverse. I hadn't heard of 2+2, and I found Pocket Fives pretty fast. I'd found you doing the podcast years and years ago, and that's how I came to know you. Spent a lot of time grinding at the time, of course, Poker Discussion, Off Topic, and then Hand Histories is where I learned a lot of stuff. So I know that you guys have all that, but it is a little bit different. It seems to me that it's really, and please correct me if I'm wrong, it's really geared towards a more of an online grinder as opposed to having a super wide variety of topics. Is it? Would you say that it caters more to that sect?
I think it caters certainly more to online players than live players. I definitely agree with that, and that's something we're working on changing now. But also, I mean, we've always been really focused on multi-table tournaments specifically. And so the bulk of our traffic has always been from players that primarily consider themselves multi-table tournament players. We've had sit-and-go traffic, and we've had some cash players over the years, but the nitty-gritty strategy discussion for those types of games has never really existed on our site.
Take me, if you don't mind, take me back to about 2005. Was Pocket Fives just an idea at the time, or is that a right around when you got started?
Yeah, actually, that's the right year. We launched the site in January of 2005, and the story is, I'll try to keep it fairly short, but I was living with two guys in Nashville, just roommates after college, and one of them was in law school, and the other two of us were kind of in a transitional period, I guess, kind of trying to figure out what to do, We both started working on, the other two of us both started working on with one other partner this project, just based on we were really interested in the tournament scene. We were playing on mostly Ultimate Bet back at the time. I guess we could have been getting cheated. We didn't know that at the moment, you know. We just knew that Phil Hellmuth was on there. But we love that Ultimate Buddy tool. Do you remember Ultimate Buddy?
No, I don't. Tell me about it.
It was just, it was kind of like a buddy list, like AIM, but for their site. And so you could see when players signed on and what tables they were at and click straight through to their tables. And that was really fun for those of us that were kind of enthusiasts. We didn't have a lot of money to play tournaments, but we were able to kind of watch the big players and in awe in a lot of ways, these guys that would win Aruba package after Aruba package for 10K each time. And so we started following these guys, and we realized that we weren't the only ones. There were all kinds of people following them. And Cal, my partner in this venture, has always been very entrepreneurial, and he had this idea. He was working on a site called Rivals.com, which is pretty famous. You may have heard of it. But they're based in Nashville, and he was working for them. And he wanted to do something kind of similar in some ways with online poker. So Rivals, I guess, was the basis for a lot of his ideas to get started with that, and he wanted to do the ranking system. That's what really kind of came out of Rivals and the forum communities, and just find a way to sort of bring people together who were interested in the top online tournament players. And so that's really where Pocket Fives came from. We would search these names that were the big winners back at that time, like BR Savage, Sheets, and Johnny Bax were kind of starting to become big names back then. Some other people, like the big names on Poker Stars back then, what was it? T-Koi, I think, was there were a million Where's T-Koi threads for years and years. that was when he was big. And so some of these guys that, you know, everyone thinks of as old timers now because it's such an industry of young people, the poker player industry. But those were the guys we were following, and so we put the site up, and we, you know, put some rankings up for better or worse of these players. They were kind of arbitrary at the time, but they got a lot of debate going, and as we started to get more input from players, we really started making the rankings more of a science and less of a kind of, I guess, guessing game or what have you. Just the more people that started participating, the more it helped us. And so I guess that's kind of how things evolved back then.
To that end, you know, Pocket Fives, I don't think I'm overstating when I say it's probably, if not the, one of the most widely recognized ranking systems for online tournament players on the planet that we have for online poker. People refer to it all the time. They even use it on their own resume. And you've seen some of the biggest names in poker get into the top 10, reach number one. What kind of grind does it take, according to either the formula or, like you were saying, the science, to get to the top 10? And is it even possible to stay there for any length of time?
It's definitely possible to stay there because a lot of people have done it. It's hard because, like you said, it does require a big grind. And a lot of these guys that are good enough to get to the top 10 also like to play live. And, you know, you go to a tournament series and you're off the online games for a couple weeks. And that can really, really affect your ranking. Because, I mean, the rankings, they're based on 40 tournaments over the last year, which doesn't seem like that much, except for really, unless it's a really big win, the only wins that really help you much are ones you've had in the last 3 months. So you've got to be pulling at least 10 to 15 significant scores per month on average.
Holy cow.
Significant, you know, like at least mid-four-figure type scores to really be hanging around towards the top of the rankings. And, you know, some of these guys that play 50 tournaments a day can do that. And we've definitely seen some really good players stay in the top 10. You know, guys like Chad Batista, you know, Annette Oberstad was a mainstay for a long time. Ape Styles, Below Above. You know, there Mormon's another really good example of a guy that's spent a lot of time in the top 10 over the years, and it's not a coincidence, obviously. And then dating back further, you look at kind of like some people like Imperium, that just, they had what it took to stay there. And what it takes is not just ability. I mean, you guys know it takes ability to win that much. You know, you're not going to win the W Coupe Championship five times in 3 months or something like that. But, I mean, they've got ability, but they also have that endurance, that, you know, that marathon, not sprint mentality of getting back into the game every day, even when they're on bad runs. And that's what really keeps them up there high.
Does a player need to be a member of Pocket Fives in order to be considered for the rankings?
They do, yeah. It was a decision we made. It was a tough call for us. When we implemented these automated rankings back about 2 years after we launched the site. It was around the end of 2006. And we had always included people in the rankings that weren't members prior to that when we were doing them manually. But a couple of things kind of swayed us. One was connecting the screen names. We rely on our users to actually put in the data themselves about what their screen names are.
Right.
And from time to time, you know, there's an issue with someone that we think is putting in a name that's not really them, and we deal with that when it comes up. But generally, people are very honest about this, and what it helps us do is avoid issues with people who don't want to be ranked being in the rankings, which used to come up sometimes in the past. They just didn't want the attention or the recognition or whatever. But also it helps us avoid issues of, we don't ever want to be displaying data about people that they don't want us displaying about them.
Sure.
You know, it's a touchy issue in this industry. There's some sites that have gone the extreme other direction, like, you know, Poker Table Ratings and, you know, Official Poker Rankings to an extent. And I don't think that their intentions are bad, but, at the same time, to me, we've always felt that we wanted to have a very positive relationship with all of our members and the players in the community. And I don't think we can do that if we're displaying information against people's will. And so that at the end of the day was our reasoning. Just, you know, it's tough because we'd like to rank everybody, but, we want to be more of a community and more of an inclusive site and not just a data mining site.
You know, when you mentioned the word community, and that's what I think a lot of people get out of Pocket Fives. It's about community and community building. When you're on the business side, you know, when it comes to community building like you do for poker, it's kind of a little bit about like grow or die. You need to continue to grow, and you have in terms of you also have training and you have various forums, but now you also have a new element called local. Is that right?
Yeah, that's the big new thing.
Yeah, and tell me about it.
Yeah, it's starting to get a little traction. We only launched it about a week ago, and so it's going to take some time for people to adapt. And you know, we're going to add some more features to the site that'll help with that for sure. But the idea came about just to give you a little history. Last year, this thing happened called Black Friday. I don't know if any of your listeners have heard of it.
Yeah, maybe.
It kind of changed the online poker industry a little bit, and so. At the time, Pocket Fives was actually owned by another company that had acquired the site from us, from my partners and me, back in 2007. And they've been running it for close to 4 years at the time. And a lot of that time, the site had been very stagnant from a development of new features perspective. It was just kind of drifting. I mean, the site was doing okay and was okay on traffic and all that, but it hadn't really modernized itself. And then around the last year before Black Friday, Nat Arum started working on the site. And I'm sure you guys are familiar with him.
Definitely.
He put a lot of effort into revamping the site, and he developed the version that's up today, minus the local part, of course. But he brought us into vBulletin and put together a lot of great ideas like the forum badges that people really like. And then right as he was kind of progressing through his agenda with all that, Black Friday happened, and the company that had purchased Pocket Fives ended up just disbanding most of its operations. It's still operating a couple of sites, but Pocket Fives is a bit more of a complicated endeavor than what they could really handle going forward, just based on their situation, which I'm not going to get too far into, but
sure.
they're a small organization now, and it just was for them to handle. And so they made the decision to split back off with the original owners, and we ended up with the site back again. And I had been doing some work with them for a while, so I was still familiar with everything that was going on, but my other two partners had been completely out of the business for years, and so we got it back in May of last year, about a year ago. And first thing we did was just as quickly as possible, we got together in person to start brainstorming about what direction to take the site in, and you know, issues range from what can we afford based on the new industry situation to what makes sense, where is the industry going, what are people going to want, not just tomorrow, but in a couple of years and things like that. And the conclusions that we came to, and I have to give my partner Cal a lot of credit for this, because really, I mean, a whole lot of this was his idea. The conclusion, though, was that poker is not going to be necessarily played on international sites going forward. There's still an international community. There are going to be venues where people from Finland play with people from Georgia or whatever. Like the World Series of Poker is a great example. But online poker especially, it's unlikely, in our opinions, that we're headed in a direction where there will be worldwide competition happening on a regular basis. And so we had to start thinking about, how much sense does it make to be focused on overall forums for the whole world, overall rankings for the whole world, a recognition system that focuses on the whole world as if everything's the same everywhere. And we've just continued to see more and more evidence that we shouldn't be focusing on that. Ever since Black Friday, we've seen a whole lot of complaining on the site from U.S. members, for example, that they can't be high in the rankings anymore because they can't play on the really big tournaments on PokerStars and some of the other sites there. And that's made us think a lot. And we've come to this conclusion that we need to kind of start splitting things off into more localized communities where people are generally able to play in the same live casinos and online poker rooms as each other, and we'll be able to talk about the same things and have things in common, and potentially even set up home games together and charity events and other cool things like that. And so that's just a philosophical change for us, really. More than, you still hear me? My monitor just went off.
Yeah, you're perfect, Adam.
Sorry. Okay. Yeah. So it's kind of a philosophical change for us, a big one, really, because we've always been about kind of treating everyone the same on the site, and we are. We're not giving preference to anyone going forward, but just encouraging people to interact more and to follow more closely the people that may be more relevant to them for, you know, a number of reasons. And it's not going to stop with locales. Locales is kind of the first step, but also we want to develop a system where people can create their own groups, their own sub communities that are closed off to, you know, invitation only or something like that, or we may head in the direction of some sort of follow system where you're able to visit a page and see all the updates on all the people you're following. And for those who haven't seen the local pages, it's not just like a forum. It's a place where you can see all the biggest caches recently from people in your state or country. It's a place where you can see how many people are on Pocket Fives from your state or country, how much money they've all won together recently and how many tournaments they've won, and who's cashing the most there. You see local rankings for that state or country, and eventually we're going to even do cities. So we're considering a lot of directions on this. We're going to have a big powwow next week and decide, you know, what's next, what's the big thing that we need to add next, because we have this whole list of ideas now. But really, the big idea behind it is let's get people together with the most relevant other members to them, rather than just kind of putting them in a big pot with everyone else and hoping that they stir themselves up correctly.
Yeah, I think that sounds like such a great idea, specifically because poker players generally love two things. They love stats and they love competition. So if they can find a way to bond with people who are close to them, and then at the same time compare their own progress to those people that are around them and also compete with them at the same time, it seems like it makes for perfect synergy. How do you deal with the live aspect? So I go out and I'm in my locales in the local section. I go out and I play a tournament here at Bay 101 in the Bay Area. And of course, Adam, you know, of course I crush. I take it down.
Yeah.
I always do. I don't mean to brag, but, you know, that happens pretty much all the time. And I cash for, I don't know, like, you know, $120,000.
Your normal week, in other words.
That's right. Typical week to put me at the top of the Pocket Fives. Bay Area locals. How does that get reported, and how do people see that? How do I get to bask in the glory?
So yeah, that's actually touching on some features that we've added pretty recently to the site. Just in the last few months, we've had a link to, and I don't mean a link on the site, but we're actually linked up with Hendon Mob, and you guys are probably familiar with them. You know, they do the live tournament reporting. They've been doing it for years and years, and they get pretty much everything that's out there. I remember them from, you know, the early part of the 2000s, so I know they've been doing this forever. But now people can actually put the link to their Hendon Mob profile in their Pocket Fives profile, and their live caches are tracked on our site through Hendon Mob. And so if you're looking at the Pocket Fives California or Nevada, wherever you guys are in Nevada, right?
I happen to be in California.
Okay, so if you're looking at Pocket Fives California, and someone in California who has their Hendon Mob profile linked gets a cash in a big tournament at Commerce Casino, for example,
sure.
You're gonna see an item on the on like the. I shouldn't call it a wall, because we're not calling it a wall because we don't want Facebook to sue us or whatever. But,
right.
You know, on the thing that looks like a wall, you're going to see something that says your screen name on Pocket Fives won, you know, $120,000 as he does every week for first place in the Bay 101. And so that's a pretty cool feature that we've added. And then also we have this thing called Poker Near Me. And they're a pretty new website, PokerNearMe.com, that we're pretty excited to be working with, because they have this really great system for showing upcoming poker tournaments in your area. And we've interfaced with them now, and on every local page, at least in the U.S., I'm not sure about non-U.S., but at least in the U.S., every local page, it's U.S. and Canada, I guess, they have a Poker Near Me tab where you can see all the upcoming tournaments in whatever region that you're looking at. So you're looking at California, I see right now, you know, Thursday, May 10th, 10 o'clock p.m., wow, so it's
Garden City.
The hour.
Yeah, I mean, I'll tell you what, I'll probably be there. I'm guessing that they're talking about the Garden City 180, right?
Exactly. And
yeah,
then
come on now.
At 10 p.m. they have the bicycle $60. And then tomorrow there's quite a long list. Gosh, I can't even see past 10 o'clock a.m. for tomorrow. There's so many tournaments there. But yeah, so we're listing upcoming tournaments in your area, and when this gets to like localized cities and stuff, that's going to be even more interesting to people. So yeah, we're going at this from a lot of angles and trying to get as much like relevant information to people as possible there.
And so it's really easy for people to sign up. Let's give them the plug. You go to pocketfives.com if you don't already have a profile there. You can just, it's super easy. Log in, sign up. There's the nice new yellow locals tab right at the top.
And you don't even need to be registered to check out the local pages. Our site will automatically sort of take a guess at where you are, and so if you go to a local page, it'll stick you in the community it thinks you belong in, based on your location, and then if you want to register for the site, great, we'd love to have you, but if not, you know, just check it out, take a look, see what you think.
Cool, Adam. So, okay, we're going to get people to check that out. Before I let you go, I've got one more question for you. I know that I get a lot of poker media people here, or poker business guys that come on the show, and you get super deep in the poker business, and sometimes you lose focus of your own game. Adam, how's your game holding up?
Oh, well, I've been kind of out of it since I moved back to the States last July. I live in Georgia now, and as far as I know, there's not even any legal poker in my state. And so, you know, I've played here and there since I've been back, but I've been avoiding the online sites in the U.S. because I don't really trust them.
Sure.
At this point, I know it's probably an unfortunate thing to say on the show, and I feel bad for everyone who, you know, is more of a grinder than me, because I know everybody wants to play. I just don't feel very comfortable with Merge and Cake and so on. I know people in those organizations, and those people are perfectly fine. It's not that I think they're going to steal or anything. I just I don't trust them not to get into a similar situation as what happened with Full Tilt and UB and AP, because you know, that is something that could happen at any time to these companies, and they could get their bank accounts frozen. And, you know, I don't know their situations, but I have a hard time really having much faith after, certainly we had a lot of faith in Full Tilt, and, you know, that didn't work out so well. And so,
could have gone better. Yeah. People think that one could have gone a little better.
So yes, it could have. So I guess you know, the answer to your question is that my game probably kind of sucks right now because I haven't been playing much outside of like live in Costa Rica when I was down there a little bit in December, and so I'm probably pretty terrible.
All right, well that is of course completely unacceptable. You will have to. You are now forced to go for some short period of time to the 2012 WSOP. Get your cash game on. Play a tournament and come say hi to us when you're there.
I would love to. Hopefully I'll get that chance.
Excellent. Adam, thanks so much for joining us. We'd love to have you back super soon.
Thanks, Jeff. I really appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Anytime. There he goes. Adam Small, Pocket Fives. Go to pocketfives.com. They're really rolling out the new local tab. And of course, you know, if by chance you didn't happen to know about Pocket Fives before, You, of course, 2 plus 2 is down for a couple more days. You should go check it out. You might find something there that you like, especially if you're one of my international listeners and you're an MTT grinder. Adam Small, thank you so much. We are going to take a very quick break. I'm going to be right back with online grinder Hurricane Jeff, Jeffrey Romano. He's going to be here on the show. You are listening to the Poker Gossip Show right here on Quadjax Live Radio.
Hey, this is Del Rockshoe in the place to be. I listen to Quadjax Radio every Tuesday and Thursday because it's JW, better known as PKRGSSP. Now that's poker gossip with no vowels, but with all the top guests, including me.
Hey, we're back. It's right around 8:40 Pacific Standard Time, and my next guest is a professional online poker player. He goes by his online moniker, Hurricane Jeff. He's also a pro player for Lock Poker. And just last night, he took down the high roller with 30K guaranteed on Lock for a nice five-figure score. Let's welcome into the show Jeffrey Romano. Hurricane Jeff, how are you, sir?
Hey, I'm great. Thanks for having me. You caught me on an upswing, so I'm going to be a little bit happy today.
I like it. I like it. You know, I would like to start something that even before you come on the show, there's good luck. So I'd like to take a little bit of credit for whatever happened last night.
All right, I'll give it to you.
Thank you, sir. Hey, right off the bat, question from the chat. Let us know, how'd you come up with Hurricane Jeff?
Oh, man, that's from my old backer. We were actually just messing around in Vegas, and I don't even know how it came up. I was just making up names on the fly, and Hurricane Jeff came up. I don't know. But it stuck, so whatever.
It stuck. Are you happily living with it, or are you stuck with it like a... I hate my own name.
You know what? I feel like everyone's online name is a little bit lame, so whatever. As long as it sticks and people remember it, I'll take it.
Hey,
what can you do?
Do you consider yourself an online specialist? Are you becoming a hybrid player? What's your game like?
Well, considering I only have like 3 live caches, yeah, I got to be an online player. I pretty much grind 10 or 11 hours a day, so yeah, definitely an online grinder.
And how long, or is poker your primary, I know it is, that's your primary income, and how long has it been that way?
Yeah, it's been that way for about 4 years. Had plenty of ups and downs, plenty of times where I've been pretty close to broke, and then, you know, plenty of times where I've been doing really well and then just blown it all at bars or whatever.
Nice.
Or, or in Vegas at the World Series, but I finally figured out how to make it a steady income, and I'm doing pretty well now.
Well, you went to school at UMass, right? And what'd you major in?
I majored in finance and operations management.
What were you going to do?
I mean, I had a pretty good internship at a manufacturing plant, and that was destined to be my job, just working operations management there. But UMass, fortunately, had a really good poker crew. Back in the day when poker was just starting out, you know, after the moneymaker boom, we had some grinders that were actually made it all the way up to, 10-20, no limit, and they were playing the highest stakes tournaments. So we used to play in dorms, or I used to play in dorms with them all the time, and they actually got me way better than I was to start out. So I got pretty fortunate there.
When you say way better than you were, I mean, what was the education like back then versus what it is right now?
Well, I mean, if you played back in the day, or at least when I played back in the day, I'd look at a hand like, you know, Queen Jack and just think it was the absolute nuts and just be ready to just gamble it up and get it in, you know. So they just brought a lot of discipline to my game and just like, I don't know, just taught me to think out hands a certain way, and it just helped out a lot. Just playing all the time is really what helped.
You've been a blogger for Bluff, and you're a Lock pro right now. Are you comfortable putting yourself out there, or were you actively trying to put yourself out there in terms of being kind of like a little bit of poker media and also being like a bit of a poker personality? I'm interested in how you came together with Lock.
Well, I got kind of lucky with Lock. I was actually their first one of their first ever signups. Not their first signup, but I was their first grinder. So they opened up, and then 3 days after they opened, I started playing, you know, 13 or 14 tables at once on their site, and they sent me an email, and they wanted me to become VIP and all this stuff. And I mean, I was still a Busto college student, so I didn't have a ton of money, but I went on a pretty good heater where I won a few 30 rebuys back in the day on Cake. I did well, you know, I built up my role to like 10K or whatever on there, started playing some 100, 200 limit, and I started raking a ton of money. And so luck offered to fly me out to Vegas, and I did, and I actually got to meet the CEO and the development team of luck. And since then, like, I've kind of just grown with them. They, you know, like back way back in the day when they really had no volume, I was their only grinder. So I got really lucky just to be their first person that signed up for their site.
What, and like, what year was that?
2008. Wow. I think it was.
And that's when they were just part of the Cake Network.
Yeah, I mean, the way I did it was I was on like a sportsbook site, a sportsbook poker site, and I wasn't getting any rake back, and as a sit-and-go grinder, that's like half your profit. So I emailed them like 20 times, and I was like, what the hell, give me rake back. And they said that poker isn't really important to them, so they didn't really care to give me rake back. So I looked on Sharkscope, and I looked at all the like skins under Cake, and I found Lock Poker, and I was like, all right, I'm signing up for Lock. And I talked to him, and I was like, can I get any rake back? And they said they gave me a small amount, but it was better than the nothing I was getting at Sportsbook. So I just stuck with them.
Well, what about at that time, I mean, Stars and Tilt, were you playing those as well?
Not really. I mean, I should have been, but I just wasn't. I don't know why I wasn't. Maybe because I didn't have a big enough role. I mean, I played them, but every time I won something, I would just play, you know, way higher and just go busto as fast as I could.
Well, I mean, sometimes that works out, right? I mean, like, that kind of turned you into, instead of being just another screen name at the monolith of Stars, I mean, you became a pretty important person to the Lock Brass as they noticed that you were, because obviously they want to become what Stars and Tilt were, and just, I don't know, I'm talking about finance or anything, I'm just talking about, like, traffic and name recognition.
No, definitely. I mean, they want, you know, they want a bigger market share. They want part of that big cake. But I got lucky, too, because Jen, the CEO of Lock, actually hooked me up with Bluff Magazine, and I did start writing blogs and stuff, and I got a little bit of recognition. Nothing like big time. Like, I still wasn't really well-known, but, I mean, it just, I feel like in an online community, just being able to put your name out and, you know, just, like, getting your foot in the door for some sort of network is really good.
I mean, it's difficult, right? I mean, because there are a lot of poker players, maybe only a handful, and what I mean by handful, I mean, like, there's obviously millions of poker players, but few who can really put it together, consistently cash, make a profit, and then of those people, turn themselves into an identity that gets out there. I mean, you got to take every break you can get if that's something that you want to do. And I guess for you and for your relationship with Locke, it was mutually beneficial, like, for you to be blogging and you to be one of their VIPs and them to promote you.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely have to agree with that. And also, like, just because they've given me whatever deal I have with them, me and one other Lock Pro are pretty much responsible for all the six-man sit-and-go traffic on the site. I mean, if it weren't for us, like, there wouldn't be half the games there were. So it's just, like, it's just really helped us out, like, everything. I don't know. Just Lock has a really good idea. And the CEO, Jen, is really ambitious, and once you get to know her, she's, like, incredibly nice. And although I've had many frustrating times with her, it's just she's still awesome.
So I know that you might not know too much, or maybe you can't tell us too much, but there's even the huge news that came out, which is that Locke is leaving Merge, and they're not just going back to Cake, they're acquiring Cake. Can you help shed any light on this? I mean, is this going to be...
Well, if you look at the progression of Locke Poker as a site, it started off on the Cake Network, and the whole concept of Locke Poker is they want to create a site that's catered towards... what the players want. Like, they want to build a site for players, for grinders specifically. So when they were on Cake, back in the day, they really wanted to give players, first of all, they wanted to have really good software, and that was a thing they really wanted to develop. Like, they keyed in on that, and then they also wanted to give players good deals, like rake chases and rake back and all this stuff. So Locke offered players certain rake back percentages on Cake Network, and Cake eventually found, I don't know if they did it behind their back or whatever, but Cake said, we don't want you giving these rake back percentages out anymore. And so Lock Poker said, all right, well, this really just isn't working. And I think Cake was kind of dying anyways at that point. It was just a weird time. So Lock left, and they went to Merge. And then merge allowed them to do all these rake chases in the beginning and all these rake back incentives and all these deals for affiliates and everything to get the just to get the traffic boosted. And then recently, merge has not allowed them to do certain rake chases and certain rake back deals. And recently there was the lock up series that was going to happen, which is the lock online poker series, which was scheduled to happen, I think, like this week or something, or next week or whatever. But so merge gave the lock, this is what I understand. Merge gave lock the go ahead to run the, sorry, I got an ad in my ear right now. So Merge gave Lock the go-ahead to run the series, and then, you know, a week or 2 weeks before they pulled the plug on it, and Lock just said, all right, that's it. That's the final straw. We're moving back to Cake. And it's great because now that they're on Cake, or now that they're going to go back to Cake as an owner, they're going to be able to do the things that they were never allowed to do on any other network. And the best part about it is that they have they've brought along all these pro players, you know, Melanie Weisner, Chris Mormon, Big Dog Pocket Fives, you know, Nikki Evans, all of them. Jared Hubbard is going to design the Sit and Goes. So they brought in all these pro players who are now going to be able to design the site or improve the site for other grinders like themselves. So now that Locke has total control of what kind of promotions they want to run, and they have a team of pros that's going to run it, I mean, I just think it's going to be a fantastic network for all these players.
Are there any other skins on Cake right now? You know, it's just kind of escaping me whether there are. And are there any left, or are they just basically?
Yeah, Cake still has some traffic. I don't know the exact stats, so I don't want to talk out of my ass. But I think when from some blogs that I've read, I think that when Locke moves over to Cake will be bigger than Merge, but it will still be like only 70% of the traffic that Merge is right now.
Well, how about this? Is there going to be any downtime on Locke when this happens?
I don't think so. I think the transition is going to be pretty smooth. I know when Locke went from Cake back to, or when they initially went from Cake to Merge, it was actually pretty smooth. I don't know if I was out of the series during that or not, but I don't think it would be more than a day downtime, if even that.
And so it seems like from your timeline, and I'm not going to hold you to it because I know that you're not like a representative of Locke, but it seems like, or it sounds like, that happened pretty fast. Like, they can't, the announcement of the cancellation of Lock Ops, in my brain, was maybe 3 weeks ago. And to go from, okay, they're canceling Lock Ops, we're tired of Merge, we're going to go back to Cake, nah, screw that, we're going to purchase Cake and take over that. That's some fast acquisition.
Well, you got to... If you met Jen, the owner, you would understand like how she has like this a vision of what a site should be, and she's pretty much unstoppable when it comes to driving towards that vision. So for her to just go acquire Cake is just another step towards her designing the site that she thinks is going to be perfect for players to play on. And I mean, if she thinks it's the right step, she's not scared to make any moves. So.
And so, I mean, like, you play, looks like, almost exclusively on Locke, right?
Right now I play, just on Locke.
And how are you able to, or how are you finding it, are you able to grind out your living on Locke? I say that actually knowing the fact that you've had an amazing May so far on Locke, but, we'll talk about last night in just a second, but has it been grinding out a living on one of the only U.S.-facing sites?
It's a little frustrating at times, but overall it's been pretty good. It's been pretty consistent. I feel like the Sit and Goes were flooded with rakes in the beginning, but since it's grown, they've gotten pretty fishy. And I mean, like, I have I don't want to go into like details about my deal, but I pretty much what I do is I rake money for the site. And so even if I'm having like a losing money, like last month I didn't cash in a single MTT. I still made $3,000 on the month because I was able to grind out sit and goes, and I, you know, I can rake up to $10,000 a month, and I get a decent amount of that back. So for me, it's been like, it's been steady, but it has been a little boring. It's definitely a grind, I'll put it that way. But now that the MTTs are getting bigger, with bigger prize pools, it's definitely like, it's not hard, I'll put it that way, but it's not easy.
And do you know if Lock Ops is going to go off? I mean, are they just going to reschedule that as soon as they can type thing?
I know that there's going to be some big things in June. I know it's, I don't think it's going to be Lock Ops, but if you're an online grinder, I would highly suggest locking yourself in a room in June and just playing strictly for the whole month through, because there's going to be some really great promotions.
Well, you said that last month you didn't cash in an MTT, but you don't have to worry about that this month. I mean, it looks like we were just talking with Adam Small, and so like I was looking at your Pocket Fives profile, and I see that you have at least four-figure caches in May alone, and last night you took down the big one, right?
Yeah, I've actually run pretty damn good this month. Part of it was in the beginning of May, like the first or second day, Tournament Poker Edge asked me to make a few videos for them. So I did, and while I was making the video, the first video I made, I just sent in like a test video, and I ended up coming third in a tournament. I was like, screw this, I'm gonna win one for them. So the next day I loaded up a 4 hour or 4 part series, and I ended up shipping two tourneys. And then since then, I just got the MTT itch, and I've been running like God, and I think I closed out like five tournaments or something. So I'm up a solid 20K in May. Can't complain.
Outstanding.
Obviously the high roller last night was my biggest score in a while, but mostly because I stick to SNGs. But I mean, I can't complain about a 12K score at all.
Are you hooked up with the TPE guys? Are you doing work over there?
I submitted videos. I don't know if they'll put them up if there was good enough content. I think it was. I shipped two tourneys, but I'm pretty good friends with Mark Aliotto and Casey Jarzabek, you know, who are owners of it. So, I'm kind of hooked up with them. Hopefully there will be some videos out soon. I don't know.
You know, there's a lot of us here in the U.S. We're aching for online poker. Maybe we haven't jumped back in yet. We're watching Scoop. We're watching Scoop here on Quad Jax. Quad Jax are doing a lot of broadcasting of Scoop stuff. But I think we're afraid of, and in fact, my last guest had mentioned it as well, like we're afraid that some of the U.S.-facing sites, like the same thing is going to happen that happened to Stars, that happened to Tilt. DOJ is going to come in, shut it down for whatever reason, or maybe the payment processing is going to go belly up. I know you're a Lock Pro, I mean, and I know that you do good work for them, but what's your opinion of that? What do you say to people who feel that way?
Well, I think that, first of all, the sky is always falling down on 2+2. Say that, you know, right off the gates. Like, I'm happy that the site's down for a week. You know, it just gives people a few minutes to breathe and recollect their thoughts. I feel like when someone bashes some site, like company or anything poker-related on there, they get this group mentality where, you know, it's okay to say anything you want about that company, even when they have no experience with it. But as far as like player safety, money wise, I mean, I can't guarantee anything, but what else am I going to do? I mean, I just have no other option. So I play on it, and I do trust, I trust Lock because I know the owners. I've met the lawyer, like they're smart people. They know what they're doing. I just have to trust them, and I do. So I guess that's all I can say. You just got to take my word for it, which isn't that great, but
I'm just asking about your opinion. Like, you're not worried about that, and you're able to cash out, and so at least, I mean, like maybe it's because you have an in, but things that go pretty smoothly for you.
I don't know. Has anyone ever not been able to get money off merge? I mean, I know it's slow and it takes a while, but everyone gets their money eventually. I don't know anyone who's gotten any money seized up from them.
Sure, sure. The you had mentioned earlier too that that you have, I guess, three live caches, but the WSOP is around the corner, and I'm asking absolutely everyone as it's approaching, what are your plans for Vegas this summer? Are you going to be out there? How's your bankroll looking? Are you going to be able to participate in a lot of the tournaments?
Yeah, I'm playing. I sold like 20K worth of buy-ins, just like a 20K package, but I'm probably going to put in another 20,000 of my own money just to play a mix of Venetians and World Series. Nice. I mean, I like having a small package sold just so I keep some sort of schedule. But I also, like, I went there last year and I sold a pretty big package to Max Katz, and I ended up just playing way too many events and getting burned out in, like, a short period of time. So I like, kind of want a little bit of freedom to, you know, just do whatever. And I'm actually kind of dreading. I go out there June 4th, and I'm actually dreading my living situation. It turns out there's this place about 2/10 of a mile from the Rio. I think it's called the Desert Rose Inn or something like that. I don't know what it's called.
Sweet.
Yeah, it's going bad places. So I didn't book it. My friend booked it, but like I found the place, and I saw these pictures online. I was like, this place looks great. You know, it's got a communal pool. It's like really nice interior, and it turns out that it's like a trap for poker players. Other people have stayed there, and actually, Paul Jeez was telling me that he stayed there and he walked into like the suite and the TV was ripped out and like roaches scattered, and they went down to get the money back and the guy just told him to piss off. So this is apparently where I'm going to stay, so I'm kind of dreading that. I'm just hoping it's going to be clean and there's not going to be
any,
like,
you got no shot. You're a super dog. You're definitely a one outer for this place to be clean, and the quote unquote communal pool is going to be
someplace
that you want to take a dip in. Forget about it, Jeff.
And,
you're screwed.
You know, yeah, we already put down the deposit, and the deposit's like half the month's rent. I'm like, oh my god. And I don't want to just get stuck $800 before I'm even out there. That's like a bad omen, right?
Desert Rose, is that what it is? What is it called?
It's something like that. It's 0.2 miles away from the Rio, so it is like a 5-minute walk, which is nice. You know, you save $1,000 on cabs while you're out there. I don't know.
Pretty soon you're gonna wish you spent that $1,000. But hey, who knows? Otherwise, you can always start a blog. You know, like Notes from the Desert Rose, and just like tons of pictures, and just let us know what it's like to just seriously 6 weeks of grind and grime.
I think I could get some traffic with that. Sounds like a good idea.
before I let you go, Jeff, you know, you're a Jeff, I'm a Jeff, you're Hurricane Jeff. I'm a slight fog Jeff.
Okay.
I don't have the gusto, but there's a lot of Jeffs in poker, and I would like to play the Jeffrey trivia game with you. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay. Now, hopefully the idiots who were on earlier, hopefully you weren't listening, so that, because they've ruined all sorts of things. Were you listening earlier?
I was not. Well, I was listening like a half hour ago.
Okay, good, good. They didn't ruin it. Okay. Hurricane Jeff, here you go. Prahlad Friedman accused this poker Jeffrey of not anteing at the 2006 WSOP. Name that Jeff.
Jeff Lissandro?
Jeff Lissandro. Bonus question, Jeff. Where's Jeff Lissandro from?
Italy. Like Genoa or something?
Australia.
Oh, Sicily?
Australia. He's from Australia.
No way. Doesn't he live in Italy now? He lives in like Sorrento or something.
I don't know if he lives in Italy now, but it's definitely he's from Australia, according to Wikipedia.com.
I played with him in a stud event. He didn't like me.
Jeff trivia here with Hurricane Jeff. Jeff, his two bracelets helped him capture the 2006 WSOP Player of the Year. Name that Jeff.
Madsen?
That's right. It's Jeff Madsen. And here's your bonus question. Jeff, is Jeff Madsen a good rapper?
Not as good as Prahlad Friedman. I don't know.
We're going to accept that. The correct answer is no, he's not. We'll accept not as good as Prahlad Friedman. Ding, ding, ding. we got a couple more here. If you want to learn how to run a company into the ground, you might ask this former WSOP commissioner about it. Name that Jeff.
I don't know his last name. I don't know it.
Do you know his first name?
Jeff.
Come on, dude. All right. Yes, it's Jeff. Jeffrey Pollock from Epic Poker knows how to run a company in the ground. Bonus question, Jeff. If you had to guess, who would you guess Jeffrey Pollock's least favorite poker player on the planet is?
Shit, I don't know. Daniel Negreanu.
That would be Daniel Negreanu. That is correct.
And that wasn't from chat either.
Okay, here's a 5-point question. This could put you over the top and make you the all-time points leader for Jeff Trivia here on the Poker Gossip Show.
Okay, let's go.
You've already been the lead for, and probably will be the all-time leader of all time. Jeffrey Popola made a name for himself by taking down his first bracelet in the 2010 WSOP by outright winning the 5K 6 Max. Once Jeffrey Popola returned home, he went back home to finish what?
No idea.
Yeah, he
finished. No idea.
He went to finish a law degree. He went to finish.
Congrats, Jeff.
Congrats to Jeff Popola, the well-known Jeff Popola. Here's the bonus question on the 5-point question. In his bracelet photo of Jeffrey Popola, I'm going to let the chat look him up. Jeffrey Popola, P-A-P-O-L-A. An unkempt Jeffrey Popola looks like a cross between which two celebrities, Jeff? Take two celebrities, mix them up, and you have Jeffrey Popola. Who do you think you could pull out for this?
Oh, my God. These are some tough questions.
This last one is impossible.
Hold on. Can I Google them?
Go ahead. Google them.
All right, give me like 2 seconds.
Zach, do we have a Jeopardy theme? No? I can't. Zach hates it. He has
Jesus, I don't know.
Did you get the picture of him up?
Yeah, I got pictures of him up.
Come on. What? In his bracelet photo, he looks like two celebrities mashed together. Which two?
Hold up.
This is amazing radio. Luckily, we can edit and post. Don't worry.
I'm looking at his face right now. I can't even put. I don't know.
The correct answer is Justin Bieber and Andy Samberg. He's a cross.
All right, I can see the Sandberg. I don't see the Bieber. I see
the
Sandberg.
Look at his hair. Look at his hair. He's got like a super mop top, and it's even flowing to the right side.
Yeah, he's got the mop top. I see the Sandberg more than I see the Bieber.
All right. Well, it was Bieber and Sandberg is the correct answer. But seeing as how you are the champ, Jeff, of Jeffrey Trivia, we will have to have you back to defend the title at a time that we accumulate even more Jeffs in poker.
Can I plug my website real quick?
Of course you can. Go for it, sir.
So me and my buddy Mark Alioto, AZN All In 007 on Lock Poker, are starting a staking website where we want to bring players that are slightly winning players to just be able to crush the low stakes sit and goes. And we want to do it in a manner that other staking sites haven't done. So we're going to take like 4 or 5 people each month, and we're going to bring up a whole page on them, like a page dedicated to tracking their progress as players, and kind of try to spotlight them and just try to improve their game. And we're starting this website in about a month. It's being developed right now, but anyone can sign up for it, and anyone can get staked. They just have to fill out an application. And the site's going to be stakemeplease.com. And it's not up yet, but it will be in a month.
Stakemeplease.com. But, I mean, not anybody, right? What if somebody comes on and they have, like, zero stat, zero cred, and they're some kind of grinder? I mean, what's the vetting process for something like that?
I mean, they can apply. They won't get backed unless they have, unless they have a reason for us to stake them. I mean, you know, if they're somehow involved in the poker community, they could definitely be staked, you know. But if they're just not if I've never seen them in the community or they have no stats or anything, they're probably not going to get any action.
Okay, but, it's going to be a month from now, and we'll bring you back on when that happens, but go ahead and dish the site one more time so people can, when they see it, it doesn't strike them as whatever.
I'll be tweeting it a lot. It's stakemeplease.com.
And that leads to my next question. Where can we find you on Twitter?
It's Hurricane Jeff, except the I is just a 1. Hurricane Jeff was, you know, already
401 Kane Jeff, right? I mean, yeah. So Hurricane Jeff with the I as a 1. Jeff, thanks so much for joining me, man. I had a really good time talking to you.
I had a good time talking to you too.
All right, brother. We'll talk to you again super soon. There he goes.
All right, take care. Go Celtics.
Go Celtics. There he is. He's the all-time leader now. I mean, like, I don't know if anyone is ever going to be able to best Jeffrey Romano's score at the Jeff Poker Trivia game. There he goes, Hurricane Jeff. Great conversation. We're going to take a super short break. Super short. Senor Zach, and we'll be back. We'll wrap up the show, send you off on your weekend. You're listening to the Poker Gossip Show right here on Quad Jacks. And we're back. Just going to wrap that up. I want to thank both my guests tonight. I want to thank Hurricane Jeff. I want to thank Adam Small from Pocket Fives. You know, prepping the show sometimes takes a lot of effort and energy, and someone who kind of goes unrecognized, and I know he'd want me to not recognize him, is Quad Jack's own Marco Valerio. Marco really helps me get a lot of guests for the shows. He reaches out, so I just want to send a big thank you out there to Marco. I appreciate all he does. He reaches out. He helps me so much prep for the show. And, of course, producer Zach. Zach's the man. He sits by, and I think he almost actually listens to the show every once in a while. Like, just when you hear that perfect fail horn, when the fail horn comes in at just the right time, that means that Zach is listening to the show. Perfect, Zach. Well done. Anyway, hey, thanks so much. We're going to be back next week. We hope you have a great weekend. Of course, hit me up. You can follow me on Twitter if you don't already, at PKRGSSP on Twitter. You can follow me on the emails or the Gmails, I should say, PKRGSSP@gmail.com. I would love to hear your comments, questions about the show. We're always looking to improve. Would love to hear your comments. And those of you who do bother to take the time, just know that those are very appreciated. Otherwise, we want you to be watching the Quad Jacks Twitter account as Zach and his fellow pros, the people who he gets in contact with, are doing a great job of streaming scoop events, especially final tables, getting big name pros to come on, commentate live, break down strategy, super informative, very entertaining. The chat goes off, the numbers go up. It's a good time for all. So I assume that's going to be happening through a lot of the weekends, of course. You know, if it doesn't happen on a particular final table, give Zach a break. The man needs to live a life. He can't just be sitting there clicking buttons all the time. He's not an online grinder. He's a radio producer and a media mogul. It's Zach. That's it, guys. Thanks so much for listening. We'll see you next week. Stay tuned to Quad Jacks Radio this weekend for Scoop Final Tables. Zach, I think that's it. Have a good weekend, everyone. Go run good.